Yo, Adam Saxon with Guy in a Cuban. In this video, I'm going to answer a question that I get a lot, which is, how do we plan for capacity with premium? It's a struggle. Let's figure it out. If you're finding us for the first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date with all the videos from both Patrick and myself. All right, planning for premium capacity. How do we know if we need to go from a P1 to a P2? Or how do we know if we're just getting started with premium? What do we need? Unfortunately, I'm going to tell you there's no magic answer here. There are a lot of factors that go into this. After I talk about this a little bit, I'm going to give you some ways that you can maybe go do some investigation, either before you're getting premium capacity or after you've had premium capacity for a little bit. So before we get into that though, the big things that we need to realize are that your data is different from everyone else's. And so it's hard to be able to answer that question for you without knowing specific details and doing testing on that given load. A couple of things to keep in mind: how many data sets do you have in your capacity? What are the aspects of the data set? So size, number of columns, number of rows, how big are they? Are we using good, clean star schemas? Are they optimized to peak performance? Are we using row level security? And those reports have 40 visuals on them, which are going to cause significant load on the data sets as well. How many concurrent users are going to go in there, and think time as part of that? So if you say, oh, I've got 1,000 users that are going to be hitting this report, are they all going to hit it exactly the same time? Probably not. So those are things that we need to consider when we're thinking about how much capacity do we need. And so the more that things are optimized, cleaned up, and really fine-tuned, the more mileage you're going to get out of your capacity. All right, so before we even get a premium capacity, we need to think about the things that I just called out: how we're planning the data set, what's all going into this capacity, are there data flows along with data sets? Those are all going to be using resources on that capacity. So prior planning before we get to the capacity. The other thing we can do is we can do load testing. Load testing is the biggest thing I can give you in terms of, is this capacity going to handle the load that you're expecting? Now, before you actually go get an actual P1 or P2, what you could do is utilize the Azure Power BI embedded capacities. So these are the A SKUs as part of Power BI Premium, and those will allow you to spin something up, do the load test, and then spin it down without that annual commitment. You're not going to use those for a production environment, but it's a good way to at least see how it's going to behave. So an A4 is equal to a P1. So keep that in mind when you're testing. All right, so you've had premium capacity for a little bit. How do we go figure out what's going on, and do I need another capacity? This is where the Premium Capacity Metrics app comes into play. I've already done a couple videos on that, so definitely go check those out. I'll link them up above or down below that you can go take a look at how to go use the Premium Capacity Metrics app for Gen 2. Let's go take a look and see what I look for when we're talking about capacity planning. All right, so we are in the Capacity Metrics app. The two visuals that I immediately look at are these two right here. The top one is going to be the overall consumption of the capacity, and the one below it is strictly looking at the overloads. This one is my red flag. If we're going over all the time, I'm under stress, right? This capacity is under load. You can see here there are a couple of blips that go up and down. This may be expected behavior within your organization. Maybe they're a one-off because you know of something that was going on in your organization. And so we can discount that. If we see continual overages and the pattern remains over time, that becomes a problem. And that's where we need to think about options that we can use to fix this. Maybe you're not having overages, but this yellow line, that is the 100% mark. That's the top end of our CPU that we have on our capacity. So from here, we could see, are we normally getting close to that line? And maybe that's an indicator that it's time to go take some steps to rectify that usage. We need more headroom for that. So these are usually the ones that I go look at. You may want to spend more time digging in and investigating on these given spikes to identify which data sets are causing the load. But in general, this is being in a crisis mode at this point, and we've got to go take action. So when we talk about that crisis mode, this could also apply when you're just figuring out which capacity you need. In the testing that you did, you found, oh, this is going way over what we thought we were going to need. There's always going to be three options. The first one is the one that I absolutely recommend, and it's also, from my experience, the one that people are least likely to go do because of the time involved and potentially the expertise. And this is Optimize. So look at the data sets, look at the data flows, look at the reports that are going on. How do we optimize those items? How do we make them go faster? How do we make them use less CPU? So reduction of resource consumption, making them go faster, allows other operations to go in and out quickly. And so that brings down the overage. It gives us more headroom as we go closer to that 100% line. So optimization is always the first option. The second option is scale out. In your situation, you may have a P1. You may have two P1s, but most everything is on the first P1. And if you find that you're going over, or you find like you're getting close to that line, you've done all the optimization that you can do. Maybe identify a given workspace that's causing significant load and get it off onto its own capacity to give more breathing room in those capacities. You know, I call that noisy neighbor type situation. One data set that's just really a bad actor and he's ruining it for everyone else. And then the last option that you have, option number three, is scale up. So this is when we've looked at everything else. We need to go from a P1 to a P2 or a P2 to a P3. So we've optimized. We can't really scale out anymore. We got to go up. We need more headroom. But those are always your three options, and you've got to work within those elements and do the investigation. So getting to know the Capacity Metrics app is key. Understanding what your business patterns are is absolutely key. And then from there, you can begin to formulate your plan for your company on what your capacity planning needs to be. All right, I want to hand this over to you. What do you do when you think of capacity planning? Are the things that I mentioned, are those in your process of how you go about determining that? I'd love to know. Let me know in the comments below and share it out with everyone else. If you like this video, be sure to hit that big thumbs up button. Smash it if you so desire. If it's your first time here, hit that subscribe button. And as always, from both Patrick and myself, thank you so much for watching. Keep being awesome, and we'll see you in the next video.